coming out here after 30 years, yeah, I ain't got nothing, but I'm going to have something because I'm rich in personality, you know, and I'm rich in love, my family love me, and that's really all that counts. Yeah, I'm looking at him like, man, you tripping, you know, this is to knock you out, but yeah, he was like, you know, so I'm mad now, and I'm starting to look at him in a different way now because you in the cell with me, so everything you do is a reflection on me, you know what I'm saying, so I'm all out of pocket, man. I'm looking for drama now. So I wait for a minute. I'm brushing my hair. I'm looking at him. I'm so disgusted. I go out in the block. And I'm standing out there for a minute. Then I said, man, I'm going to holler at old dude. So I go up there and holler at him. Boom, boom, boom. What's up? He come out, man. He said, what's up? I said, man, look, man. What's up with you and my seller, man? He was like, that between me and him, man. He, you know what I'm saying? He was disrespectful. He owed me money. That's between me and him. If he want, you know what I'm saying, some get back, he trying to run again, tell him come on up here. We can go one-on-one. He can get whatever he want. You know what I'm saying? But he going to get my money. So I'm looking at him, and I know everything he's saying he right, but I'm looking, you know, see if he going to come all crazy on me, because I'm like, man, I'm vexed about that, because, you know what I'm saying, so I'm like, yeah, all right, man, you know what I'm saying, okay. You know, he was like, yeah, you know, I ain't got no problem with you. I ain't got no problem with you at all, man. It's your selling, man. You know what I'm saying? Tell him get my money. I said, I ain't gonna tell him nothing. You done already told him. I just was trying to figure out what the beef was, what's going on. You know what I'm saying? Because I don't want no drama coming in there to that sale. He said, I ain't got no beef with you, man. I said, yeah, all right. So I peel out. But I'm a little vexed, man. I'm more vexed at him than anything. Because he tell me he gonna wait. What did you wait for? When somebody do something to you, you do something right then and there. You don't let that stuff linger around or nothing. So I go in there with him, man, and everything, man. I don't even hardly say nothing to him for the rest of the night, right? So the next day, I told the story before, so if you heard it, you bear with me. I'm going to move on to something else, but I think it's relevant to what I'm talking about. But I go ahead on and bear with him, man, and then, you know, the next day, I'm assuming he told his crew. You know, he told Ty and all them. And then, like I told you, Ty hum a dude, but he going to roll with his boys. He don't start nothing, but he'll finish something. You know what I'm saying? And Jew-Man at the time there, Jew-Man with whatever type of business they want to be with. If they trying to get it in, he going to be the loudest one. He going to be with them. You know what I'm saying? Because like I say, he had a mean little crew. I can't think of this other dude's name, man. I hope I do for this video off. But anyway, like I say, man, so, man, he run around, man. A couple of days go by. I'm looking at him in pure disgust. He up in his cell, man. I'm like, man, this dude crazy as I don't know what. But he telling me, yeah, man, yeah, I know you think I forgot about old boy, but I got something for him. I said, yeah, man, whatever. You know what I'm saying? Whatever. It don't even make me no difference. You know what I'm saying? If I was you, I told you when you should have held it in. I got him, though. I got him. I said, yeah, all right. So I won't even really try to, you know what I'm saying, holler at him. But anyway, man, like I said, a couple of days go by, maybe a week. And back then, man, you could have all these personal items, man, which they eventually took out the system. But back then, you could have personal robes. You could order, like, from JCPenney's or whatever, personal towels, washcloth. You know, it wasn't really nothing, but it was something because it was something that gave you a sense of feeling like you had something of your own, something that was different from everybody else. Because everybody wear the same clothes, everybody wear the same this, that, and the third, same boots, everything, underclothes. Unless you ordered or had people that love you enough, send you money, you could order your own personal stuff. You could have your own personal underwear with it, just one white. You could have, you know, colored boxers or, you know, different color rope. You know, so it made you give you a sense of you had something, man, when you won't just locked out from everybody else, man. I felt good when I had my own stuff. But saying that, I say that to say this. Because you go get in the shower at the time on Augusta, it ain't nothing but four showers. 80 dudes, 82 dudes now, four showers. So when you go get in the shower and you hang your towel across, you know what I'm saying, the plexiglass in the back, people can look at your towel and tell the people had the different showers, different towels, the distinctive towel, they knew who was in the shower. You know, little small things like that you get used to by you know, muscle memory. You, oh, that's such towel, that's such, you know, that's such robe. So on this particular day, Charles, he done got in the shower, right? Boo-boo up there in they cell, and to put the thing in the door. You put a pillow or something in the door, cover the door when you're using the bathroom, taking care of your personal business or whatever. You didn't supposed to, but everybody did it. You know what I'm saying? So he done put something up in the door. Charles in the shower. You could know what shower he in because of the towel. This was dangerous as well because there are people plotting on you. They know where you at and when you there. So Charles went and got in the shower, whatever, whatever. Evidently, Junie and his crew, you know, Jew man and them crew, they done plotted on the man. And the rest of these dudes that's in the crew don't even sleep in the block. So we out in the block, you know, everything going on. It's evening time or whatever. Next thing you know, you see Jew man, Ty, Junie, them coming in the block with the other dudes. They don't sleep in there. They already out of pocket. So that's going to automatically alert people something going on. Now, all these cats is in the block. They go to Ty cell. They church up, whatever, whatever. Get the game plan together. Woo, woo, woo. So I'm standing over in the corner, but I'm peeping all of this. So I see Junie come to the cell. He sleep with me. So he go in the cell. So when he go in the cell, I go in the cell behind him. Ask him, what's up? Because I see the play. So he said, oh, no, I'm going to take care of my business. I'm going to give it to him. I said, oh, yeah. He said, yeah. So, boom. He get him a little padlock. We got the little master lock. He get him a padlock. He put the padlocks on his hand like brass knuckles. So he grab a cup and he come out, right? So I go out by the cell. I stand by my cell. I'm just watching to see this, you know, extravaganza, you know, unfold. So I'm standing over there. I'm waiting. And he's just standing over there by the hot water tank, which is right by the shower. When you come out the shower, you step over the lip, and then you look to your right is the hot water tank. If you look to your left, that's the booth that, you know, the operates the doors or whatever the person is working up there. So he's standing right there for a while. You know, Ty come over there and say something to him for a minute. They go back over there. All the weightlifting crew standing over there by Ty's cell. So they waiting for about 5-10 minutes, and the water stop. And then I guess he waiting for Charles to come out the shower. So Charles is in the shower. Charles then got himself together, whatever, whatever, but we in prison. Normally when you in prison, man, dudes come out the shower. Sometimes they ain't got nothing on but they roll. Some dudes come out, they get so comfortable. They come out with just a towel wrapped around them and then they shower shoes and walk on to their cell. I ain't never done that. You know what I'm saying? I ain't never get that comfortable. I ain't never do that. When I come up out that shit, shower, I'm at my shoes on. And I'm be dressed enough where at least I got on some shorts. Maybe a wife beat or something, but I'm gonna have on some shorts. But I'm gonna have my shoes on for reasons just like this. So he come out the shower. He got a towel wrapped around him, right? He got his washcloth, his soap dish, whatever else in his hand, shampoo. So he come out, stump his feet, step across the lip. Soon as he step across the lip, and turn and look, Junie throws some hot scalding water in his face and take off on him. Shoo! Boom! Punch him in the face. He fall back down on the floor. Junie jump on top of him and start pounding. Now, mind you, Junie big, like I say, bigger than him and muscle-wise. But Charles ain't no little cat by no means, no stretch of the imagination. So they rumbling all on the ground, Junie hitting them, Jew man, all them hollering, kill him, man, beat him. Beat him, you know, beat his butt, blah, 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 all the, you know, profanities, whatnot. So, man, Charles is scrambling and trying not to get hit. Junie trying to hit him all in the head with the locks. Man, next thing you know, man, he done maneuvered himself in a way where he up under Junie and they tussling all over the floor. Now, I wanted to stop this right here just to tell y'all this for all y'all young cats watching this. Now, all of this going on and you supposed to have somebody in the booth that's supposed to be the security. Had she been on her job and paying attention to this, this would have stopped right there because she would have called the code and the people would have came running. She ain't nowhere to be seen. She ain't even paying attention to this. This lets you know how you can get killed in penitentiary. Because had that Bethlehem been in play, there wouldn't have been no knots in the head. There would have been some poking going on and dude would have been dead. You know what I'm saying? So that's what I tell y'all. Ain't nobody going to save your life in prison but yourself. You know? But anyway, they rumbling. Charles and got up on the man and Charles went from being on the ground getting punched. Blood is already, you know, circulating right now. He bleeding. Charles got on his knees from on the ground to on his knees to standing straight up and pick Junie all the way up off the ground and slammed him down so hard, man, you can feel the power shake. Boom! Then he got on top of him. He started beating him. Junie still got the locks. Junior covering up. They tussling and rustling around. They get back to their knees. Now they tied. They super tied. You can see it's like a wrestling. They just swinging, you know, super tied, trying to hit each other. And they holler, get him, man, get him, get him. So they tussling, but to me, it looked like Junior done lost his heart now because dude fighting back so hard, and it's like he's starting to get out on Junior. So they grabbed, he grabbed him again, pick him up, and boom, slam him back down to the ground. They rolling over, tussling. It's like a real drag-out fight. Then they holler, man, come on, Junior, come on. So they get up, both of them, real slow. When they separate, they get up real slow, and they like in slow motion, they have blood all over the floor. Charles trying to keep him slipping. His towel done fell off. He fighting buck naked. You know what I'm saying? Junior got the loss on his hand. So they tell him, get him, man. Get him, man. Don't let him. Get him. So Junior like hesitating. Then he swing, hit him. Boom. Charles back up. When they holler, get him, get on him. Man, it's like I'm watching the whole thing, and I'm watching his face. He like look over, and I guess that moment it acknowledged to him, this cat got all his buddies in here, all these weightlifting dudes right here with him, and he ain't got nobody. And he just, boom, look at them, look back at Junior. Junior hesitate, he take off running. He run, he sleep upstairs. He run up the stairs. His door is blocked and locked because, you know, the boy in there doing whatever he doing. So he go upstairs. When he go upstairs, his cell is right there. He don't even go to his cell. He just zoom down that way. And some people got their door open, some don't. So I can remember them hollering, man. I think it was either Taiju, man. They said, man, get him, man. Don't let him run to his cell. He might be going to get a knife, man. Get him. So Junior started running up there behind him. He run down the tier to the first open cell he seen. And he run in the cell, which was two white boys, two young white boys sleep together. And he started banging on the top of the joint. That's how you get your door closed. Bang, bang, bang. Close my door. Close my door. So the lady in the booth must have noticed and heard the noise and look over there. She see this big, tall, black dude, buck naked, standing in the door that she know ain't his, hitting it, bleeding profusely. Close the door, close. So she panicked and she closed the door. He locked in the cell now with two white boys, and they can't get to him. He locked in. So he get up there to the cell. He said, yeah, I told you I was going to get you. I told you I was going to get you. They hollered, come on, man. We got to go. We got to go. They called the police. We got to go. So he tell the man to go back down. They try to get their game plan together, man. Tell him to change your clothes. Change your T-shirt. Take the blood shirt off. They change that stuff. They try to get out the block, go out on the yard so they can be incognito. He up there in the cell stuck with these two white boys, which later on, when everything was over, them white boys was like, man, he came up in there just naked, man. Bleeding, we ain't know what to do. They sitting in the cell like this, like, what is he doing in here? They scared to say something to him. He's standing up in their cell, buck naked, bleeding. They in there scared to even talk. Man, it was just crazy. I'm telling you, man, you can't make this stuff up. So they was tripping when it was all over. But he stay up in there, tell the police come. The police come. Everybody go to your cell. They screaming and hollering and all that. They go up, and, you know, I guess Boo Boo heard the noise of the police coming in and holler, everybody go to their cell. So Boo Boo done took the thing out the door. I know I told this story on one of these platforms, but Boo Boo take the thing out the door and look out the door, man. And he just look around, and I guess he looked down and he see the blood on the floor. And he see the towel, the visual. He know that's Charles Tower. And man, this is like a scene from the movie, you know, like what you call it, like the Exorcist or something. He just changed, man. He just put his face in that door and started banging it. Open my door, open my door, open my door. And people kept saying, ain't no doors open. Everybody go to your single. And he looked out there and he put his face in that door. And he just started screaming, Charles! Charles! Ah! He said, if y'all did something, Charles, I'm going to kill you, MFs. I'm going to kill you! Charles! Man, it was crazy, man. They started, police telling him, be quiet, shut up, help you! Charles! Charles! Man, it was crazy. They go down to the cell with Charles at. They open the door. They get him out. They try to ask him what's going on, why you bleeding, whatever, whatever. They cuff him up. They take him out there. buck naked. He walk on about the block. He try to stop it himself. Try to tell Boo Boo what went on. I'll be alright. I'll be alright. Just don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Nah, nah, nah. Who did it? Who did it? I'ma kill him. I'ma kill him. Who did it to you? Charles, Charles. It was crazy. It was a madhouse, man. But yeah, man, dudes went out on the yard, they closed down wreck, started telling people to come back. You know what I'm saying? Man, I'm trying to remember, I think Junior got locked up. They just got locked up on investigations or whatever. But it was just a mad, mad scene, man. It was crazy as I don't know. And I'm going to tell you this, and I said it before too. If Junior ain't had them locks, man, Charles would have did the thing to him, man. He'd have did the thing to him. Because even with them locks, Charles still was strong dude, man. And he was fighting, man. He was fighting for his life, but he was fighting. You know, but Junior, like I said, he ain't had that killer in him. You know what I'm saying? He ain't had it in him. And I don't think he anticipated getting the fight that he got, you know, because he made his move. Boom, with the hot water, boom. He thought he was going to just drop him and do what he could do to him. But that ain't how it turned out. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, man, it was just a crazy. But that was my selling. You know what I'm saying? But I didn't get involved because he got his own crew. He got his own clique. So I'm just sitting back watching. You know what I'm saying? I ain't got nothing to do with it. That's them. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, man, I can remember that incident just as crazy as I don't know what. And like I said, I tell y'all that incident because of the simple fact, like I say, everything that look big don't mean they're going to go super hard. Man, because like I say, size don't mean nothing in the penitentiary. It's the size of your heart, how far you willing to go, what you willing to do, how much you willing to sacrifice. Because make no mistake about it, every time you step out there on the battlefield, not only you may have the mentality that you going to do what you got to do, you'll take a life if you got to take a life, if that's what it called for, whatever the situation may be, you also got to understand that at that same time, it's two sides of every coin. Your life is on the line. Somebody may take your life. So all of that go into play too. And that's why I say, if you can't live like that, prison ain't the place for you. Because like I said, it's going to come. Confrontation is going to come to you one way or another. And you're going to have to be able to deal with it. And if you don't deal with it emphatically, you're going to have more and more and more problems. That's just how it is. Because people in there prey on the weak. That's what they do. They prey on the weak. You know, and like I say, situations, you have to be able to read these situations the right way. If you can't read them the right way, and that one mistake can cost you your life. You know, and I learn lessons on there all the time. I always learn lessons on there. And a lot of lessons I learned, like I said, I learned the hard way because I didn't know. Because I was green, because I was uneducated to the whole prison system. I ain't been locked up before. I'm still early in my years. I ain't got 10 years under my belt, you know, when I'm on Augusta. I ain't even got 5 under my belt on Augusta at this particular time. So I'm learning too. And I'm already realizing and acknowledging that I'm in a zoo, man. I'm in a human zoo. You got people in here that's animals. You got people in here that's savages. You got people in here that care zero about your life. Zero. You see what I'm saying? If you are ends to their means, they will eliminate you. You drop dead today and fall out there, walk right over top of you, same people that was talking to you yesterday. But they say, oh, well, Banker was all right, but man, hey, you know, yeah, woo, woo, woo. And that's just how it is. And until you get that understanding, man, you're going to be lost in there, man. So it's just, like I say, every day is a new experience. Every day is a learning experience. And like I say, I went through a lot of trials and tribulations on here. All of them I can't even tell y'all about because this video will be too long, you know. But I can remember one incident that was a learning experience for me. I think I said it too, maybe on the other platform. I'm not sure. Because like I told y'all, I don't write this down. I just go off of memory. But I can remember being out on that basketball court. That basketball court was a danger zone too, man. Because everybody get out there and try to play. Everybody can't play. Everybody get out there who, even if you can't play, if you lose, they got an attitude. If they win, they bragging too much, we give another dude an attitude. If a dude checking you too hard, then you got an attitude with him because you can't get your shot off. All types of dynamics is just breeze confrontation. And I can remember being out there, man, balling, which I didn't want to ball as much. I wasn't ever the best dude, but I was a good shooter and I liked the exercise. So I balled every now and then, even though knowing that it was drum out there. And I can remember I was balling out there one day, man. I was getting off on the dude, man. I mean, this day, man, I was just hitting everything, every shot, and I was talking trash, man. And the dude that was checking me, he was about my size. Yeah, you my size back then too. I'm young. He couldn't do nothing with me. So I'm a spot up shooter. When I shake him off and push him off me and get open and get the ball, I'm knocking it down. So I'm talking trash to him. He get mad. His teammates screaming at him, hollering at him or whatever. So he get to try being rough with me and talking trash to me, but he shoot me little elbows and this, and I tell him off the rip, you better check yourself, boy. You better check yourself. Man, I ain't up to play ball. You know, but he kept on doing it. So he did it one time, man, when I took a shot, and I missed the shot, but he ran into me and hit me and almost knocked me down. So when I got up, I said, man, you know what I'm saying? What the F wrong with you, man? So he said, man, F you. Bloop, bloop, bloop. Knocked him, slam out. Just like that, three-piece. Bam, bam, bam. Knocked him out. So he hit it. We on concrete. We playing ball on concrete on the gust. He hit the ground. Bing! Then he hit his head, you know. So he messed up. You know what I'm saying? So dudes come over there. So I'm like, what's up? What's up? Because I don't know who would have. I'm like, what's up? Don't nobody approach me. Don't nobody get around me because you don't know. You know what I'm saying? So they go over there, aid to him, get him up. I'm like, man, y'all fight, man. We trying to play ball. Woo-woo-woo. I'm like, whatever it is, man. You know, he ran up on me. So, boom, they get him up. They get him conscious. They talk to him. He bleeding or whatever. He's sleeping in the block with me. You see what I'm saying? So, boom. So when they get him up and everything, they get him on his feet. I'm asking him, what's up? I mean, what's up? You trying to go? He's like, nah, you got that. You got that. Woo, woo. So me being so green, I'm thinking, okay, all right, everything, all right. He know I ain't the one. You know what I'm saying? Don't nobody else say nothing, man. Finish playing ball. They do their thing, whatever. Shh. Man, that lesson right there could have cost me my life, man. I told you, man, I can't remember exactly what it was. A week or 2 weeks, a couple of days, whatever. But I'm out there, I'm playing poker, right? And this man came up behind me with the lock in the sock and clucked me, bloop, and knocked me to the floor. Now, I think I told this on its own, but when he hit me, just being honest, man, I seen so many stars, man. I seen more stars than I ever seen in the sky on a starry night. And man, it was just twirling around in my head, man. And I could feel it not growing in my head. And I'm like, whoa, had he hit me one more time, boom, I was finished. But instead, he wanted to run his mouth. He wanted to make sure everybody who was in the block knew what I did to him. So he wanted to make sure that they know what he did to me. So he talking loud and trying to get everybody to look at him. I told you, put your hands on me. Yeah, you think I knock me out? I kill you, wah, wah, wah. Woo. And the more he talking, I'm hearing him and I'm trying to pre-bargain with him like, all right, okay, you got it. You know what I'm saying? You got it, all right. But all the time, I'm getting myself back together. I'm getting back and more back together. The stars is getting less and less. Less and less. Till I'm down to 3, 4, then I'm just seeing 1. And then I'm like, okay. And then I'm on my knees and I'm getting ready to try to stand up, and he standing with the lock and the sock standing in front of me running his mouth. And man, that joker let me stand up and I'm like, okay, bro, okay, you know what I'm saying? No, you don't. And he let me get close enough to him. Boom, boom, I drop. And man, when I drop him, he fall in and the little lock and the sock fall out of his hand. And I picked that thing up and beat him, man. I beat him until he came in there and stopped me, man. And I'm going to tell you right now, looking back in retrospect, I'm glad they did come in there and stop me, because if they don't come in there and stop me, man, I would have beat them to death. That's just how mad, frustrated, and disappointed I was myself to be caught like that. But I was so mad. And then I'm mad at these cats at the table. They play poker with me, Eddie. You let this dude walk up behind me. And when I got out of jail, I was trying to get at them, you know. But it was a learning experience for me. And that was one thing that I knew all the time, but it just solidified it in me early. See, like I say, I was fortunate enough to get some of these lessons early in my bit, that you don't put your hands on another man and let him stay around you and assume that you safe. Assume that you done scared him so much that he don't want to bother you no more. You can scare a dude into killing. You can scare a dude into killing. You can make a dude so embarrassed or so disappointed in itself that he'll sneak up on you and kill you. I've seen it done. In later years, I've seen it done. You know, dudes that wasn't killers, dudes that won't build like that, but their pride got involved or people got in their ear and put a battery in their back. You gonna let them do that to you and they make a move that they ain't even really want to make. But once it's made, it's made. Once a life is gone, it's gone. You see what I'm saying? So he could have simply came up behind me like he did with the Lock and the Sock. He could have had that Bethlehem and I wouldn't even be talking to y'all right now. You know, so I was blessed. I was lucky. You see what I'm saying? I was lucky, you know. But man, that's just how it go down in there. You just got to learn every day. You got to understand what you up against. You got to understand where you at. If you put your hands on somebody in prison, hopefully you'll never be in prison. But if you put your hands on somebody in prison, you got to get them away from you, man. You got to get them away from you. I don't care if you think they weak. I don't care if you think they soft. Whatever. I told you. I remember a dude, man. He played this white dude for weak, man. He took his stuff. And he took the audacity to go out there and play cards the next day, knowing that he done took this man's stuff, and the man's still in the block. White boy came right up behind him and stabbed him in the top of the head and killed him. Killed him right there in the park. Right there in the park, you know. And he won't build like that, but he did it. You see what I'm saying? You ain't nobody no killer until they kill. So... yeah, those hard lessons, man. They real, real hard lessons, man. So, like I say, man, every situation that you get into in prison, man, is a potentially deadly situation. Is a potential situation that might take your life or somebody else's life. You know, you're going to have altercations in prison. That's just what it breeds. It breeds altercation, you know. But you have to be ready and prepared to do whatever you got to do. Because, like I say, even if you have to hurt somebody or take a person's life, it, you know, and for you, for self-preservation, it's better than losing your own. You know, it's better than losing your own life if you got the will to live. But these are situations you'll be put in prison, man, and whether you want to be or not, you know, whether you want to be or not. And it's just it's a crazy dynamic, man, because you could defend yourself and put yourself in a position where you hurt somebody or take somebody's life, and that could cause you never to get out. But what is the alternative? If you get killed, you ain't getting out neither. And you'll never see your family again. So it's just, it's prison, man. It's horrible. It's horrible. I'm not gonna lie to you. I told you it's horrible. And like I say, Augusta was mad crazy. It was mad learning experience. And I did learn a lot on it. It ain't no ands, ifs, or buts about that. But at the same time, I think it put me on the path that I ended up taking the rest of my bit, where I felt like violence solved everything, where I felt like, well, I know what I do, so, it gave you a sense, a false sense of invincibility, because I felt like knowing that I would do whatever I got to do, that ain't nobody gonna mess with me. That ain't the case, because once people know that that is your mentality, if they do have an altercation with you, they already thinking murder. They already thinking they got to kill you because they know what they dealing with. But in my mind, I felt like, well, once they know this about me, then they know, you know what I'm saying, what they dealing with when they deal with me. So it ain't going to be no problem. That is not true. That is not true. There may be problems, but you better be prepared to do what you say you're going to do, because that's how they coming at you. Otherwise, yeah, it's going to keep a lot of people off you. But the serious ones, if they got an altercation with you, you know how they coming. You know, and you have to understand that, man, because it's a wicked situation. And it's a wicked environment, man, that you don't want to ever catch yourself in or be in. And like I say, man, I want the most dangerous person in prison. I was the most dangerous self in my mind. But you had dudes in there that didn't even have the morals or the principles that I had. I was never going to attack nobody just because. I was never going to try to do nothing to nobody just because I felt I could take advantage of them. That was never my position. But my position was, if you oppose me, I'm going to do whatever. And I don't care, because I'm going to feel like I'm protecting me. But you got dudes in there that got the mentality that they're going to do whatever they want to do to whoever they want to do it to. And that's a different position. But you have those type of mentalities in there. You see what I'm saying? So it's just crazy, man. It's crazy. And I, you know, That's why I feel blessed out here every day, man. I feel blessed out here every day because, like I say, I feel blessed to even have got through what I got through to be here talking to y'all, trying to give y'all this lesson, man, that you would never have to go through it yourself. And that you may share it with somebody else and try to stop them from going through it. If you know somebody that's on the wrong path, you need to let them know. Whatever path you're on, you need to get up off of, because if it leads to prison, it ain't where you want to be. It's going to be worse than anything you ever imagined, anything you've seen on TV, anything that you went through out here. That's going to be worse because you have no say-so in what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. Zero. You just have to react and respond. And that's just what it is, you know. So like I say, Augusta taught me a lot of lessons, man. I went through a lot of things on there. And like I say, some of the incidents y'all already know about is a lot more that y'all don't. But you know how I ended up leaving. I ended up leaving with the big ramming thing and the big dude thing. So that just combined. The people ain't want me there no more. They got rid of me. So I ended up getting gone. Next stop, Mecklenburg. Another prison, more prisons, man. More problems, more issues, more different things to deal with, more different type of attitudes, personalities, characters to deal with. That's what it is. You have no say-so in where you go. You have no say-so in when you go. They come pack you up today and say you're going here, you're going. By force or by choice, but you are going, because you're going to be on that count list for that evening to be there, and they're going to get you there. Even if they get your body there, they're going to get you there, because they have to get you there. So that's just what it is, man. But Augusta, man, it taught me a lot of lessons. I was glad that I survived that, man, with just a couple of scrapes. Nothing, you know, real serious. But I learned a lot. And I learned a lot in every prison I went to, because I had to. But, man, it was rough. And I was early. I was early in the bit. Still, you know, that's how fast things happen in prison. Prison is not going to wait for you to catch up. You're going to have to catch up to prison when you get in there. They don't care that you don't know nothing. They don't care that you green. They don't care that you just start. They don't care nothing about that. You're going to have to catch up to speed of what's going on to be able to better protect yourself and to be able to better navigate yourself through the time that you got to do. So, yeah, man, that was some of my experiences on Augusta. I maybe revisit Augusta, maybe revisit some of these characters that I told y'all about in Augusta, because a lot of these dudes got some stories within themselves. But y'all let me know in the comments what y'all want to know about. Let me know in the comments how you think, how you feel about this video. If y'all want me to continue, next stop, Mecklenburg, y'all let me know. But in the meantime, I appreciate y'all, man. I love y'all for the support. TBP stand up. All my members, stay tuned. I'm going to try to start doing Zoom videos with all my members so we can just sit there and chat and talk about whatever y'all want to talk about. I want to see y'all faces or whatnot, since all y'all have seen me. So stay tuned. I'm trying to figure that out and work that out. But everybody who supported me in 2022, man, let's ride out and let's spread this message, this positive message, man, this positive energy, man. All negativity, you can keep it to yourself. We on a positive movement over here. We trying to reach some people. We trying to help some people. We trying to change some courses in people's life so they won't end up in the place that I end up in. And that's what we trying to do over here. So everybody who ride with me, I appreciate y'all. Y'all go check out my cooking page, man, Banky Pound. Pure deliciousness. We cooking that stuff over there. So y'all rock with me in 2022. I'm rocking with y'all. As I tell you all the time, I ain't going nowhere without y'all, man. And that's just what it is. So keep supporting, and I'm going to keep on doing what I got to do. Love y'all out there. Be safe. Be smart. Make good decisions. And always duck that hook. Bye.
Banking special.
Yeah.
Pure delicious.
Pure deliciousness, man. My name is Banky, man. Everybody calls me Banky. That's the name that I got from my grandmother when I was young. I'm coming out here after 30 years. Yeah, I ain't got nothing, but I'm going to have something because I'm rich in personality, you know. And I'm rich in love. My family love me. And that's really all that counts.